This is the 10-Minute Teacher Podcast, episode 704, Face-to-Face School and SEL, Smiling Behind the Mask, with Erica Boomsma, sponsored by Chalk.com. Welcome to the 10-Minute Teacher Podcast, hosted by author, educator, speaker, and mom, the cool cat teacher, Vicki Davis. Vicki's guest, 18-year career educator Erica Boomsma, is in South Dakota, where they have been teaching in face-to-face school for the last several weeks as of today's air date. Erica is a dedicated fourth grade teacher who specializes in teaching a culturally diverse student population. On this episode, she talks about the positive experiences her students are having amidst the masks and shields. She also shares some of the techniques she uses to help students and herself cope with the fear of going back. Face-to-face school may be a better alternative than you would imagine, even for those who struggle with worry. Listen to Erica's experience and figure out how you can prepare yourself and your students for the day you walk back into your classroom. Enjoy!
As we prepare to teach in a blended or distance learning environment, a rock-solid lesson planner is a must. I use a free program called Plan Board for my lesson planning. Stay tuned at the end of the show to learn how you can start planning in Plan Board for free. So today we're talking with Erica Boomsma. She is from South Dakota, fourth grade teacher with 18 years of experience in Huron, South Dakota. And Erica, you are face-to-face and your passion is SEL. So we're going to talk about some of the social-emotional learning requirements of face-to-face school. And I also have to say I'm in face-to-face and you and I both have been going for quite some time with a face-to-face environment. So Erica, describe for us a little bit about the protocols. Are you wearing masks? Are there special requirements you have for face-to-face?
Yes. So we have been 4 weeks in school, face-to-face in the Huron School District in South Dakota, and masks in Huron are required because we're in stage yellow. There are three stages. Green would mean we don't have to wear masks, it'd just be recommended. Red, of course, we would be distance learning again. So I have a classroom of 27 students in my fourth grade, and we also have shields. So not only do we have our masks on, but we also have shields that surround their desks, and that's what we do every day. And we practice a lot of cleaning
and hand sanitizing and washing hands. Now, your passion is social emotional learning. And, you know, there are a lot of folks who say, well, I would rather have my child at home than have them having to wear a mask, having to wear shields. What do you say to that?
I understand everyone's perspective. This is a different time where it's casting any sort of judgment on a parent's decision for their child. I would never make that. However, I will say there are advantages to being in that classroom face to face. And I know some of it is for me as a person. I feel like I'm whole again. I'm in my teaching mode. I am Miss Boomsma. I'm with my kids. I'm right there. And that feels great. But more than that, I see my children who missed school. They missed each other. They missed their teachers. They missed learning. And being in a classroom, even though we are very, I would say, cautious daily, constantly about washing, hand sanitizing, all of it, keeping the shields up, they could not be happier that they're at school with each other again. And they couldn't be happier learning. So I would say if you're on the fence, I would ask my district if I could at least see what it looked like and have my child participate for a certain amount of time.
I'll tell you, my students are so happy to be there. They are so happy to learn, and we are going faster than I have ever taught before. Do you feel that way?
We're going fast. They're excited to be there and learn. But is there a little part of you where I don't know if we would have to go distance learning? And if we do, I have to have things in place for them so that it isn't like what it was in the spring. So I feel like I'm kind of hyped up too to keep us moving in that forward direction.
And we got to have our A game going. But isn't part of our A game right now asking kids, how are you doing? I mean, for a million reasons we're asking that.
Absolutely. I mean, COVID-19 has been an awful thing, and I would never regret saying that statement. I don't want to teach through this again. But there are some things that COVID brought forward out of the woodwork into the public eye. And one of those is making social emotional learning a priority. And I feel like when we say that, you can hear like every teacher that's listening go, yes, because we've been calling for this for years. We have wanted social emotional learning as a part of our everyday routine. And while others have maybe deemed it as more unnecessary or sometimes even worse, I've heard people call it fluff. Now, taking care of our students' needs, their basic needs, their physical needs, but their mental health and well-being. This is in the forefront. I couldn't be happier seeing and knowing that we're going to be starting, hopefully, a new style of teaching that's going to use that every single day. And you know, there's a really good reason for having social emotional learning in our classroom so that our kids can take on information in a way where it will actually stick with them.
So as you started school and as you've gone through these 4 weeks, what are some of the things you find yourself saying as it relates to SEL skills?
I think that I find myself talking a lot about taking, of course, those deep breaths. Now, that can be a little bit difficult because we are in full mask all the time. So we do need to go outside. We have our mask breaks. We did a talent show for multiple reasons, making sure that the kids got to know one another, felt that joy of showing off in the classroom in front of your friends. But really, it got us from behind the mask a little, we got to see each other's faces. So I find myself saying, we need to go take a break. We're going to walk outside. We're going to have reading class outside. I also find myself asking them a lot more, how are you? And I know I've always done that, but how are you? Do you want to talk about anything? Do you have any questions? Are you feeling fearful? Are you feeling safe? I think that that's important because I know that they are on edge. No matter how ready we thought we were, I know that my kids are a little bit on edge and they can feel that off of me. For myself, I didn't realize how important my face has always been to my teaching. I mean, I know that, you know, my voice and my eyes tend to give my kind of mood away. And I've really relied on my smile to kind of bring that softness to my kids. And now that I have to block that part of my face, it's really important that I make my eyes a little lighter, that I'm using a joyful voice, a voice that I've never taught with before, kind of more cheerful, more empathetic. And that's just my tone. Even when I'm talking to you, I find myself using my hands more than I used to. I feel like I'm way more expressive because I have to get a message across that in a different way that I never have done before. And I can't help but say, you're right, it's your A game. I feel like by the time this is over, we don't just have an A game, we have an A-plus game. Like, it's this is next level.
So, Erica, what are your kids saying? Because, you know, for me, the hardest part was the first step out of my car on the first day. That first step felt like I was walking on the moon, like out of the spaceship. Did I was stepping on the moon because it just felt so foreign.
It did. I mean, I cannot tell you how much that resonates with me. I think I almost thought when I walked to my room, something was going to go wrong, or this, what was going to happen tomorrow.
Or like everything's going to blow up, or like you're still in such shock that I was in school one day and then I wasn't for a very, very long time.
Exactly. And you do, you just anticipate tomorrow. And it's always that anticipation of, oh no. I found my kids, when they came in, they were so quiet, almost nervous because, you know, we are also grade level in here on South Dakota because we have so much diversity here. What we found was that our different buildings had different socioeconomic levels attached to them for our kids, and we didn't want that anymore. So we decided for equity, we would have a K-1 center, 2, 3, and 4, 5. Well, that meant that our fourth graders never got to come visit our school. They never got to meet any of us. So they were just coming back. They were nervous about meeting everybody. They were very quiet. But I'm telling you, it took about 15 minutes for them outside together to be like, oh my gosh, we're back. We're here. They are very happy.
Did they have nerves at the beginning, and has it changed, or did they just jump right back in?
I can say at the very, very beginning, they were definitely more cautious in general of everyone around them, their classmates. Now they're a little more open with one another, but there are days when you can see them recede back in. And one of those would be because we just had the South Dakota State Fair, and that's in Huron. And that became kind of a source of contention because we had kids who were going to go to the fair. We had kids who said, no, you shouldn't. And so we really had to kind of put, you know, just that to rest, that choice is okay, but we have to remain safe. Now we're in a red zone. So the kids are getting a little more wary again. How many cases are there daily? And we just practice mindfulness. And let's take a deep breath. You are okay. We're safe. We're together. And we're here right now. And I think that my kids are coming out with that mindfulness of this moment, maybe more than any other class I've ever had. We live for right now in that classroom. And then they get a little fearful, bring them back forward, and we move on together. It's just kind of an ebb and a flow that doesn't really have a pattern. You just have to be willing to read your kids.
When I knew we were going back face to face, you know, there's all this talk out there of, you know, how can you do it? It's irresponsible. It's, you know, all the reasons that you can't. And it, at first, I guess you could say I was sort of agreeing with all those reasons. But now that I'm back face to face and the kids are back and we just had Hurricane, what was it, Sally come through, bad weather, had to go home a little early yesterday. And the kids were like, oh, well, we're excited to go home 30 minutes early, as long as we can come back tomorrow, right? And even though there was bad weather and there were a few people who didn't have power or whatever that couldn't come in, I was shocked. Like, usually, if you had such bad weather, you would have a lot of kids missing. They aren't missing because they want to be there. And when you see how eager they are for that social connectedness and wanting to be there, and that it is possible to do it. I'm not going to say safe because there's nowhere that's safe, but it is possible to do it, right?
It is possible. And we're living it right now here in Huron. I will say when I came back, I was probably one of the most hesitant because, you know, I worry. I mean, fear is always a part of that, but I'm always worried about something for someone else. I mean, that's what teachers do. We're thinking about that greater good. It's like you said, when the kids were there with me, I don't know, it's a part of me came back that had been silenced. I don't know how to explain it more than that. Like, even though I was teaching distance learning, I wasn't totally myself. And when you're a teacher and you don't feel like you're making that impact that you could, it's easy to just kind of withdraw. So getting back to becoming in that classroom, you're the teacher, that felt great to me. Having the kids be there with me, seeing their attitude towards school. So many of my kids this year aren't there because mom makes them. But I was so surprised how much they missed library, how much they missed school. They missed math, but they really are picking that all back up at a pretty incredible rate. So whatever's working for your school district, and when it does become safe enough, then being able to get back into the classroom is wonderful. I don't know if I'd be happy if I were going back without the mask mandate, though. So
yeah, we wear masks too, and we have, you know, one-way traffic in the hall and distanced, and, you know, everybody has where their desk is supposed to be. We have protocols. You just have to have protocols. I mean, they're children.
Well, and we don't even have music in the music room. That's in our classroom, arts in our room. The library is outside. We have these great lawn chairs that sit out there for an entire class, and they sanitize themselves through solar power. And then the kids check out their books online, and our librarian does an incredible amount of work to make sure the books get in their hands. The mandates put forth, whatever rules those have to be, when you follow them, there is the possibility of opening up.
Yeah. But you know, fear, you know, you've always heard the sayings, no thing to fear but fear itself. And you've heard, you know, Winston Churchill says, never, never, never give up. You know, all these quotes from history. And you're like, oh, that's a nice quote. These quotes mean something now to me. I don't know about you.
That's true. Fear does play a really important role that, you know, I've always thought that teachers should definitely be in charge. I am pro-teacher leadership. But now I'm more convinced than ever that every leader needs to have their first advisor be a teacher. Because while we were watching COVID kind of spread throughout the nation, and you kind of saw the response to this pandemic, it was kind of like looking at my classroom. You know, when I have a little person in my room who is, you know, neurally typical child, and also is very emotionally stable, but all of a sudden comes to school and you can see that anxiety in them right away. You're just like, an alarm goes off to you and you're just, how, my goodness, what's going on with this little person? On the opposite end of that spectrum, you have another student who, again, very neurally typical, but then they come to school and they are emboldened, like almost rebellious and aggressive. Right away, that same alarm goes off and you're just like, oh my goodness, what's going on with this little person? And if you look at what's happened, you can kind of see that happening throughout our population. And the one thing that fear and, you know, maybe feeling timid and even that aggressive rebellion, both of those behaviors stem from fear. And so I think we needed to have definitely teachers reaching out. And, you know, a teacher right away would address the environment right around that little person and say, okay, we're going to find out what's going on. We're going to seek counsel. We're going to not just tell you we're here from you, but we're going to start kind of building that protection around you and bring you back to peace. And I think that's what we all need to. We need to have that kind of calm brought back to us. We are together. We want to keep each other safe. We're going to take care of one another. And we can do this if we work together.
We can. And I think just being open with kids and, you know, the very first day, I said, you know, our enemy is this virus, not each other. We're going to get through this together. We're going to be safe. We're going to work through it. And you know what? However long this takes, whether it's next year or you're 42, we are going to get together and have a mask burning party when this thing is done.
We are.
Big old bonfire, you know. But we're going to take our time and see what happens. Well, Erica, thank you for your time and thank you for your authenticity and your openness. And educators who are hearing, we've brought you a lot of different types of classrooms. You've got high flex, you've got distance, you've got face to face, you've just got all different kinds. But there's a place for all of us. We all have to be under our authority and go with where our states are and where our communities are and move forward. But we can do this together. Just know that when it's time and you take that big step onto the moon / your school from your car, that one step is the hardest, and the second step gets easier, and the third step gets easier, and the fourth step gets easier. And then when those kids get in the room, like Erica said, we're all smiling behind those masks. Thank you, Erica.
Oh, thank you.
As we prepare to teach in a blended or distance learning environment, a rock-solid lesson planner is a must. I use a free program called Plan Board for my lesson planning. My school uses Plan Board with Chalk.com's curriculum planning tool. This powerful tool links with standards and gives us the ability to do some time-saving, efficient reporting, and tracking. The best thing about Plan Board is I can plan my lessons anywhere, on my Mac, my PC, my iPad, or even my phone. Wherever I work, my lesson plans are with me. And as I said, Plan Board is free for teachers. Check out Plan Board now and sign up for free at coolcatteacher.com/planboard. That's coolcatteacher.com/planboard. And join me and thousands of educators everywhere for this amazing lesson planning tool. Thanks.